Hello everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Pushing the Boundaries of Micronization in Drug Delivery, presented by Lonza. I'm Joe Keenan, contributing editor to Fierce Pharma, and I'll be moderating this webinar. Our speakers today are Salvatore Mercuri, PhD, Head of Research and Development at Lonza, and Michael Grass, PhD, Principal Scientist, Product Development at Lonza. You can read their full bios on the right side of your window. Just a few technical notes before we begin. The webcast is being streamed through your computer, so there is no dial-in number. For the best audio quality, please make sure your volume is up. You can find additional answers to some common technical issues located in the Help button at the bottom of your screen. The webinar is being recorded and will be available on demand within 24 hours after the event. We will follow the presentation with a Q&A session. Please submit your questions using the Q&A button on the left side of your screen, and you can do that throughout the presentation. I think we're ready to begin. Michael, please go ahead.
Thank you, Joe. As Joe mentioned today, Salvatore will be taking us through some micronization best practices for various applications. And before he begins that, I'll just give a brief overview of Lonza's small molecule development offerings with a focus on formulation design and particle engineering. With the recent acquisitions of Capsugel and Micmac, Lonza now offers solutions for API manufacturing through final dosage forms, covering all stages of development and across many technology platforms. We currently support over 300 development projects and more than 200 commercial products, in addition to many preclinical design programs. As you can see here, we offer technologies over quite a wide range of both API synthesis and formulation space. We offer capabilities for addressing low bioavailability compounds and as well as those requiring modified delivery. We have over 20 years of experience as leaders in several areas of process design and formulation development. We have the largest micronization capability of any service provider with plants in the US and Europe. We're a recognized leader in solid dispersions, offering both spray drying and hot melt extrusion with approved commercial products and numerous clinical programs. We also offer lipid-based formulation design and manufacturing for semi-solid and liquid-based formulations with liquid-filled hard capsule and soft gel facilities. These capabilities in addressing solubility issues are complemented with the ability to modulate PK with technologies to meet any drug delivery profile, including extended release, zero order release, colonic delivery, taste masking, or pulmonary delivery. It is worthwhile noting here in this webinar that our high-potency API production capability is complemented as well with particle engineering, which Salvatore will talk about, in contained environments, as well as specialized dosage forms designed for low-dose and highly potent APIs. Our suite of bioavailability enhancement technologies cover a large range of technologies, with assets supporting early development through commercial manufacturing for many of these approaches, and support across the US, Europe, and China. As you can see here, are various sites around the world that support these different applications. Size reduction is the focus of today's webinar, and is one of the tools that are disposable for particle engineering to address applications ranging from powder handling to oral bioavailability, pulmonary, transdermal, or parenteral delivery. Other technologies that fit into particle engineering, as you can see here, include melt spray congeal process to form multi-particulates, spray drying, and hot melt extrusion. The selection of one of the previously mentioned BA enhancement approaches is driven by our fundamental approach to problem statement definition, formulation design, and testing. We incorporate scientific understanding with our extensive experience to solve your challenging problems. Micronization can be used to address bioavailability challenges through increasing dissolution rate, and is also used for many other applications, from powder handling to making suspensions to particle engineering for pulmonary delivery. And these are all areas that we have worked in and continue as a focus at Lonza. For pulmonary delivery in particular, particle size, shape, and density are all critical performance parameters. At Lonza, we've taken two different approaches to solve this problem. Depending on the API and the target product profile, either spray drying or micronization is used in order to control these parameters to optimize delivery of an API to the lungs or nasal cavity. So thank you, and I'll now turn it over to Salvatore to go in depth on micronization for us.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for the great introduction, Michael. Today, I'm going to speak about the micronization process, and in particular, I would like to give you a brief overview of which are the kind of parameters we can work with in order to properly develop a micronization process, but also which are the kind of equipment available on the market, or at least the most used one. To begin, I would like to just introduce which we mean by grinding. The grinding is a mechanical reduction of a solid coarse material in smaller particles. As you can see, this is a really open definition, and in particular, the entity of the size reduction that we would like to achieve for our formulation process, it could be achieved with different kind of machine. So if we look at the table in the right slide of this slide, that is taken from the USP Pharmacopoeia, we can see that just four groups for the particle size reduction are defined. In particular, we can have, according to the USP, a coarse material when we have a D50, so the 50% of the population of up to 355 micron. We can have a moderately fine powder in a range of 355 and 180 micron, and a fine powder in a range between 180 and 125 micron, and a very fine powder when we deal with a powder lower or equal to 125 micron. If we look at this classification from a more technological point of view, if we, for example, take into consideration the tableting process, dealing with an API with a DV50 of 100 micron or an API with a DV50 of 20-30 micron, it makes the difference in terms of process condition, in terms of issue that we have to solve in order to properly formulate this product. This is the reason why on the left side of this slide, I proposed a more simple classification, I can say, when we that is also more correlated to the kind of equipment that we have to use in order to achieve this size. I divided in crushing when we just need to deagglomerate the initial the incoming material, and so we need to reach a distribution down to 10-50 millimeter. The pulverization, when we really need to handle a powder in the real sense, and so having a powder down to particle down to 100 micron, or the micronization, when we really need a really fine powder, and in this case we can consider a range roughly from 20-30 micron until 1 micron. In all these cases, when we have a particle size reduction, we have to deal also with increasing the specific surface area. I can say that usually this is what we need and what we are looking for, but unfortunately, the increase in the surface area is also correlated to some of the main drawback of the size reduction that we will see in the next slide. So just to give you an idea, I try to figure out the different kind of machine that could be used in order to achieve the size reduction. And I highlighted in red the jet milling, that is the focus and the core of today's presentation. You can see that with jet milling, we can roughly achieve a particle size from 80 micron to 1 micron. In this case, I can say if we look not at the D50 of the distribution, but more at the D90, so the 90% of the population. So let's go a little bit more into detail. So why we need to choose the size reduction? I can say we can usually approach the size reduction for two main reasons, the biopharmaceutical or technological. If we start with the biopharmaceutical aspect, I can say that looking, for example, an API that has to be orally administered, we would like to increase the dissolution rate, increasing the surface area. And this is especially important for BCS class 2 product, where we would like in this way to increase the bioavailability and consequently also to achieve a dose reduction with an improvement on the therapeutic efficiency. If you look at other way of administration, we can, for example, have an improvement in the penetration capacity for the solid particle inside the airway if we are looking to a formulation for inhalation purposes. Or we can have an improved tolerability for ophthalmic product because we can, with the size reduction, completely remove or drastically reduce the coarse component of the particle size distribution. I can say the last example I put in this list is the increase in the coverage capacity for the topical product. So if we look for the other side, to the more technological aspect, I listed here, for example, the syringeability, because reducing the size and removing the coarse fraction from the powder, we can improve the filling of the syringe, so we can avoid the clogging of the needle during this operation, or we can improve the physical stability of the suspension, or improving the mixing between two powder, because for sure, if we need to mix two powder that have a similar particle size distribution, this will improve our blending performances, but also it will reduce the risk of segregation. We can, in this case, I can say also paradoxically improve the flowability of some particular kind of crystal, as for example, the needle-like crystal or the plated-like crystal, because in this case, we can assimilate more to a sphere the single particle. Or we can, for example, improve the functionality of lubricant, like for when we need to use it for the tableting. So as every process, also the size reduction rely on some drawbacks. I listed as first the change in the bulk properties because, as I mentioned also in the first slide, we cannot avoid the increase in the surface area. And in this case, the increase in the bulk density that have a negative effect on the flowability of the material, except for rare cases like for the needle-like and plated-like crystal that I mentioned in the previous slide. The major side effect of the micronization is for sure the polymorphic interconversion or the surface amorphization of API. And in particular, the surface amorphization of the API can rely on a recrystallization during the storage, and it is strictly correlated with the formation of strong agglomerates. I can say the agglomeration phenomenon is something that it could be also mediated by other effect, like for example the increase in the free surface energy or the formation of electrostatic charges. If we look at the final effect, so the when we deal with a recrystallization, we will have at the end really strong agglomerates. Instead, when this aggregation is just due to electrostatic charges, so we are not dealing with real agglomerates, but more with soft aggregates. Another well-known side effect is the decreased wettability and for sure the formation of a fine particle. We would like to achieve a size reduction, so unfortunately we have to deal with the fine particle. And in particular, the fine particles are correlated to the contamination of the working place, but also to the risk of dust explosion in case the product it will be combustible. So if we start analyzing more in detail the site reduction process, but in general, but in particular the micronization, we have several kind of forces that that are responsible of the comminution of the particle. I listed in the slide the most common one: smashing, breaking, attrition, splitting, cutting, crunching. I can say each kind of equipment has predominantly one or two of these kind of stresses as in the core mechanism. But if we look more in detail to the micronization itself, I can say that we can practically reduce to the crunching and the smashing as the two kind of stresses that we are to dealing with. In particular, when we deal with really crystalline material or really brittle material. In all the cases, when we deal with a size reduction, in particular with also with the fluidized energy jet mill, we will deal with some friction. So I can say that we can try to reduce as much as possible, because sometimes this is correlated also to the increase in the temperature, but in some cases we cannot completely avoid this effect. All these forces can generate a strain, a deformation on the particle, and how the particle reacts to the application of these forces, it's really dependent on the some of the characteristics of the powder itself. First of all, it depends about the hardness of the powder. An hard material, it's easier to be comminuted compared to a plastic one. And in particular, if we deal with brittle material, it will be much easier to achieve the size reduction. Another effect that could drastically impact the site reduction process is the adhesion, so the propensity of the material to adhere to the internal surface of the equipment that we are using for the comminution. In this case, what we can do is, for example, to commill the API with a glidant excipient, like, for example, the silica, in order to reduce as much as possible the layering effect on the internal surface. Also because we have to think that in some cases the addition can affect just the yield of the process, but we can continue the micronization or the grinding. But in some cases it's so extreme that we need to shut down the equipment, clean it and start again. So it can could have a drastical impact on the process. Another parameter that is really important is the glass transition temperature. For sure, in case we need to micronize or to reduce in size a product with a really low glass transition, we need to cool down the equipment and the product itself in order to be able to reduce just by collision the particle. In a similar effect is present also, is correlated to the water content of the product, because the water acts like a plasticizer. And so we have two solutions in this case to achieve the size reduction of the particle just by collision. The first one is to, for example, to pre-dry the material before to start the comminution when it's possible. When it's not possible, we can exploit water content, high water content, in using cryogenic condition. This way we can freeze the water and we can increase the brittleness of the particle, and so in this way we can achieve the comminution. The last I can say it's the parameter I would like to discuss in this slide is the plasticity, and it's strictly correlated to what I discussed until now. So consider if we have a particle that react to the collision just by deforming itself instead of forming some crack, or it avoids the comminution, what we can do is, first of all, apply cryogenic condition, but we have to to think that in any case, each single material has a minimum diameter, a critical diameter that we can reach. If we try to decrease the size of the material down to this critical diameter, the material, it will be in any case, it will have a plastic, it rely on a plastic deformation, so we cannot comminute it no more. This diameter is typical of each single material, so it's something that has to be carefully evaluated. So if we look right now at the kind of jet mill that are most commonly available on the market, but that can be used to achieve micronization, we can for sure have the fluidized bed opposite jet mill, loop mill, and spiral jet mill. The first one I would like to show you is the fluidized bed opposite jet mill. If you look at the cross section of this jet mill, it seems a long stainless steel pipe with three or more grinding nozzles placed on the bottom, and these nozzles are placed on the same plane. On the lateral wall, we have the inlet of the powder that usually is performed using a double valve system. And on the top part of this equipment, we have a rotating basket, a wheel, that is responsible of the powder classification. So the powder is fed laterally and can reach the milling chamber. In particular, by gravity, will reach the nozzle level. The gas entering from the nozzle and expand rapidly inside the milling chamber and accelerate the particle against each other. The collision generates the comminution, and the particles are drained on the top part of this equipment by the gas stream. When the particle reach the classifier, the fine fraction can pass through the classifier. Instead, the coarse fraction is pushed again on the bottom side of the mill and can start again the comminution cycle. I can say the main effect we can have in this kind of jet mill is the particle-on-particle collision. And what is important is that we can separate the portion of the mill when where the comminution take place, and it is in particular at the nozzle level, and the part where the classification take place, that is in the upper part of the mill. It is important because we can in this case modify the two parameter. We can decide which is the cutoff of the powder that can leave the jet mill, but we can also independently increase or decrease the energy we deliver on the powder. I don't want to go too much into detail for the classification, but just to, if we try to simplify, we have two dragging force. The first one that I reported in blue, in the circle we have in the right upper slide of side of this slide, where we have the component of the gas stream that need to be exhausted by the jet mill through the classifier, and then we have I can say this force is responsible of the radial velocity. And then we have a centrifugal forces that is related to the speed of the classifier. In practica, if we increase the circumferential speed, we can decrease the size of the particle that can pass through the classifier. Instead, if we increase, for example, the pressure we apply during the comminution, we will increase the size of the particle that can pass through the classifier. I can say this principle it's common to all the kind of jet I will show you today. So the second kind of equipment is the loop mill. In this case, the cross section it's much simpler than what we saw for the opposite jet mill. You can see that there is a with number two it's indicated the injector, the Venturi injector that is used to feed the powder inside the milling chamber. In particular, on the bottom side of the milling chamber, that is indicated with the number six, we have the grinding nozzle. So the powder is fed through the and accelerated through the Venturi injector, reach the bottom side of this mill. The nozzle, and in particular the gas expanding at the outlet of this nozzle, accelerate the particle, and that start colliding each other, and then are also in this case dragged on the top part of the mill until they reach the classification pipe that is indicated with number 8 in the schema. Also in this case, the fine fraction can pass through the classifier. Instead, the coarse fraction are pushed again on the bottom side and start again the comminution cycle. In particular, I can say that we have two main differences compared to the from the loop mill to the opposite jet mill. The first one is that we cannot separate in this case the comminution part from the classification part, because in this case we don't have a dynamic classifier but what we call a static classifier. So we cannot I can say modify the classification, the cutoff of the powder during the process. So we can just act on the pressure. And the second difference is that in the bottom part of this mill the nozzles are placed in a way that allow a certain turbulence. So the principle for the comminution is not just the particle-on-particle collision, but we can also have to take into consideration the collision between particle and wall and some friction. So compared to the previous one, we have for sure an improvement in the throughput. We can say that the loop mill is a little bit in between a mechanical mill and a real fluidized energy jet mill. The last one I would like to show you is the spiral jet mill. In particular, if you look at the cross section, the one reported in the lower right slide, side of this slide, we can see that the shape is like a toroid. We have practically two chamber. One is represented in dark blue, and is where the grinding gas is collected. And we have the real milling chamber that is represented in the picture in light blue. So the grinding gas that is is collected in the dark blue chamber has the opportunity to enter inside the milling chamber just through the nozzles that are placed radially and on the wall of the milling chamber. In this case, the gas entering can enter to the nozzle in the milling chamber with a certain angle that we can decide, and we will see in the future slide that could have an impact also on the process development. Instead, the powder is also in this case can enter the milling chamber accelerated through a Venturi injector that is represented on the left side of the picture. So the powder enters the milling chamber. It's accelerated by the gas expanding from the nozzle in a sort of a tornado-like shape. The coarse fraction can I can say can stay on the peripheral part of the chamber. Instead, the fine fraction can follow the gas stream until the center part of the jet mill, where we have the static classifier and they can be exhausted. Also in this case, as for the for the loop mill, we cannot discriminate the grinding the part of the mill responsible of the comminution from the part of the mill responsible of the classification. In particular, it is possible to modify the classification, but just when we work in batch, so we need to geometrically modify the static classifier in order to modify the cutoff of the powder that can leave the jet mill. So we described until now three different kind of jet mill, but for sure we cannot work just with the jet mill, because it's just the core part of the equipment. For sure, in order to achieve the micronization, we need in any case to have some other components that work, that play together with the jet mill. In particular, we need a feeding unit. In the picture here, I represented a double screw feeder, and we need in any case a cyclone filter to separate the powder from the gas stream and to properly collect it. So considering there are several kind of technology available in order to achieve the mechanization, which are the criteria we can use in order to define which is the most suitable equipment we can use for that particular material? I can say we can divide in at least in four different groups the kind of the aspect we need to take in mind when we decide for the right equipment. The first thing is in regard to material characteristic, and in particular the hardness of the material, if it is hygroscopic or not, the kind of particle size we would like to achieve at the end of the process. The melting point, but I can say more the glass transition temperature, and so on. I don't want to go too much into detail, just to give you a rough idea of which are the parameters we have to consider in order to choose the proper equipment. We have to, for example, to have in mind the kind of accessory we will need. For example, it is needed a mechanical feeding, or we need a special device in order to properly feed the material. We need to control the temperature, and if yes, in which way, liquid nitrogen, dry ice, just a cooling jacket or so on. The kind of operation we would like to perform. It is necessary, for example, to work under sterility. There are some particular kind of cleaning procedure we have to apply for that product. The cost, because sometimes it's maybe the main driving factor, which is the throughput we would like to achieve for that product. And last but not the least, I can say, is the safety. We can have to properly evaluate the risk of explosion for that product, and or the toxicity of the material, or for example, if it's needed to apply some particular safety modification to the equipment, we have to apply some safety measure to the equipment in order to properly work that material. So after this first overview about the equipment and the parameter we can use for the micronization, I would like to show you a little bit more in detail how it is possible to develop a micronization process. So the first variable we have to be dealing with is the grinding pressure. And in particular, if you look at the top part of this slide, from left to right, we have the impact on the particle size distribution of an increase of the grinding pressure from 6 bar to 9 bar. As you can see, considering that on the x-axis of this graph, we have the particle size expressed on a semi-logarithmic scale, we can, switching from 6 bar to 9 bar, we can have a huge change in the particle size distribution. Also, if we just look at the right side of the curve, but instead of just looking at the shifting to the left. If we look instead to the feeding pressure, so if we try to modify the feeding pressure, keeping constant all the other parameters, so feeding pressure and grinding pressure, what happen? If we look on the bottom side of the slide, on the left, we have a particle size distribution achieved with a feeding rate of 11 kilo per hour. On the right side, we have a feeding rate of 40 kilo per hour. As you can see, in this case, increasing the feeding rate, we have an opposite effect. We have an increase in the particle size. So, summarizing, the increasing grinding pressure lead to a particle size reduction. Instead, an increase of the feeding rate lead to a particle size increase. Unfortunately, it is not always so simple to achieve the right particle size distribution, just modifying the operating parameter. It is sometimes needed also to act on the mechanical parameter in order to achieve the requested specification. In particular, I listed here just the most important one. We can modify and evaluate the impact of the chamber diameter, so the impact of the scale up and of the jet mill scale, the shape of the milling chamber, the chamber height that has a di direct impact on the volume of the milling chamber, and in particular on the residence time of the powder inside the jet mill. Moreover, we can modify the micronization nozzle angle, and we can act on the static classifier. I reported here powder axial passage section, because if we look on the bottom left side of the slide, we can have a cross-section of the mill. We can see that in order to leave the jet mill, the powder has to pass from this tube pipe, and the distance between the tube pipe and the length of the pipe can be considered a critical parameter. So, in considering that there are several mechanical parameters that we can change, it's impossible and difficult, I can say, to explain which is the impact of a single modification on the particle size distribution. I say this because sometimes we have a synergic effect when we try to change two or more mechanical parameters together. This is the reason why, to show you the impact of this modification, I reported a development. I would like to use the plot that we generated during the process development with a design of experiment. In particular, on the top part of this slide, we have from left to right an increase in the nozzle angle from 19 degree to 45 degree, and on the X1 and X2 axis of the plot, we have the milling pressure and the feeding rate. So, just to give you an idea, we can focus, for example, on the point that in the first plot and obtained with the 19 degree angle is in orange red, and is in particular the one obtained with the highest feeding rate and the lowest pressure. And if we look just at that point, overall, and how the particle size, and in particular the DV90, change when we increase the nozzle angle, we can see that there is a for example, for this particular material, a decrease of the DV90 when we increase the nozzle angle. If now we try to look, have a look at the bottom side of the slide, where I reported the same kind of trial, performed exactly in the same condition, but using an elliptical weir plate. So we reduced practically the volume of the milling chamber. So from just comparing the same angle, we can see that there are some drastic differences, but also if we compare from 19 to 45 degree, the result obtained with 19 and 45 degree with the elliptical weir plate, we can have a completely different behavior of what we obtained with the standard weir plate. So this is just to give you an idea of how the parameter can the mechanical parameter can interact each other, and that just changing the nozzle angle or changing the kind of shape we would like to use for the milling can have a drastic impact on the particle size distribution. In particular, just to I would like to show you with this two picture, which is the impact, for example, of the two kind of milling chamber, the standard one against the elliptical one, on the crust formation. For this particular product on the left, you can see we experienced a huge crust formation or deposit of product inside the milling chamber. Instead, switching to the elliptical wear plate, we were able to drastically reduce this effect. The last mechanical parameter I would like to show you is the impact of the classification tube. You can see that on the two extreme. On the left, you have a standard jet mill with a standard classification tube. On the right, the PSD obtained with a standard jet mill at which we removed completely the lower classification tube. Also, in this case, you can see that removing the classification tube, it affects drastically the classification of the product, and so we will, without classification tube, we can obtain a much coarser material. So, in order to give you an idea also of the development of a really challenging product, I would like to discuss today this representative case study. In particular, the request in this case was to achieve a certain particle size distribution for an API that was for inhalation use, and to avoid as much as possible the surface amorphization of the API, because in this case, the recrystallization that was quite fast after the micronization gave rise to really strong agglomerates. The first things we did was to discuss with the customer about the kind of parameter we had to study during the this developmental phase. In particular, at the end of the risk assessment, we were able to identify some operating parameter, but also some mechanical parameter as the most important one for this particular process development. Considering the number of variables we had to study, we relied on a fractional factorial design. So, in this slide, I just reported the kind of parameter we studied with this during this development. In particular, regarding the process parameter, we studied the more classical one, so the powder feeding rate and the micronization pressure. Instead, regarding the mechanical modification, we were able to test the impact of the scale-up, the nozzle angle, the volume of the chamber, and the impact of the static classification system. I don't want in this presentation to go too much into the detail of the design of experiment and the result of the design of experiment, but I would like more to focus on the approach, the methodology that was used in order to achieve the goal of reducing the particle size without affecting the stability of the product. And in particular, in this case, in order to identify the best working point, we had to install several probes on the equipment because unfortunately the jet mill itself, it's like a black box. The only way we have in order to acquire information about the process is to collect as much data as possible before and after the passage through the jet mill. In particular, in this case, we installed, we controlled the temperature of the main gas line, pressure and flow rate for feeding and grinding line. We monitored the temperature and the pressure on the outlet of the jet mill, but also the temperature and the relative humidity inside the glove box. So this was this is just a picture of the isolator that we used for this trial, and in particular, I would like to show you the size of the equipment that was used for this test. That is a lab scale equipment that was fully installed in the isolator, and the probe were installed on the outside. So regarding the result, at the end of the design of experiment, we were able to acquire a huge amount of data, and that helped us to understand better the behavior of the process of the product in the different process condition. In this case, I would like to focus on two things: the way we calculated the specific energy. I reported in the table the theoretical value and measured value. Just to explain better, both value were calculated according to the same formula for the specific energy. The difference between the two is that the theoretical value were calculated according to the theoretical pressure that we applied on the process for that particular trial, and transforming this pressure in flow according to the diameter, the theoretical diameter of each single cross section of the jet mill. Instead, in the measured value, I reported the specific energy that were calculated according to the data measured by the different probe we installed on the equipment. As you can see in the plot, where I reported the theoretical the energy calculated according to the theoretical value and the energy calculated according to the measured value, you can see that there is a huge difference between these two values when we work at with an high specific energy. In particular, in this case, the product was for formulation use, so the energy we had to deliver to achieve the particle size distribution requested was quite high, and this means that the process has to be developed in a range where the difference between the two way to calculate the energy was higher. Relying to the measured parameter allow us to properly define the working condition for that product, and in particular, using this calculation, we were able to define a design space where it is possible, and you can say also a working point to scale up then in production, where it was possible to achieve the particle size distribution, minimizing the surface amorphization of the API and avoiding in this way the stability issues. So in the last part of this presentation, I would like just to show you the micronization offer inside the LONSA, and in particular, I can say we are in the field of micronization since more than 60 years, and in particular, not only in the micronization, but in the field of particle engineering. We handled more than 1,000 compounds, and we can have the largest capacity spread on two different sites, one in US and one in Europe. Regarding the two sites, in particular for the micronization, we have a micronization site in the US, in Quakertown, Pennsylvania, and another site that is placed in Switzerland, in Monteggio. Both sites are equipped can manage a huge capacity of more than 1,000 metric tons per year. The Quakertown site is equipped with 11 GMP suite, and the Monteggio site with 19 GMP suite. You can say the Quakertown site is more equipped also on mechanical milling and dynamic powder classification. Instead, the Monteggio site is more equipped on spiral jet milling and on cryogenic milling. Both sites can manage highly active API with the proper containment level, and can manage products from the, I can say, really small lab scale until the industrial scale. Both sides are inspected by FDA, and the Montage site that is placed in Switzerland is also inspected by the local authority, Swissmedic. Both sides are accredited by the Japanese authority, PMDA, and so on. If we would like to have a look at how the different sites of loans are disposed in the world, we can have in both the Quaker Fund and Montage site that I said, cited in the slide, in the previous slide, but we have also the site of Bend in US and the site of Edinburgh and Bromley in Europe that are really focused on the solid based version and lipid based formulation, as mentioned was mentioned by Michael in the first part of this presentation. I would like just to focus that for sure micronization and in general particle engineering is just one part of the general offer of loans. We can offer a broad range of services from the API synthesis until the final product and the packaging. And in particular, I can say it's a way also for working with us, it's a way also for the customer to reduce the risk associated to the process, because we can work from the really, we can manage the project from the really lab scale development until the industrialization, and with I can say a proven expertise in the field of particle engineering. So I hope to have some of you as a future customer, and I will thank you for, and I conclude here my presentation.
All right, I think we're ready for questions. Thank you, Salvatore. We have a lot of great questions already, and we'll try to get to as many as possible.
Okay, thank you.
So our first question up is, what are the best parameters for AirJet mill to reach D90 below 5 micron?
Oh, it's a really interesting question. I can say that the kind of parameter we need to use are strictly related to the characteristic of the material, but generally speaking, in order to reach a DV90 over 5 micron, for example, with a spiral jet mill, we need to rely on really high specific energy values. So this means, for example, really high pressure, 9, 10 bar, and really low feed rate. The feed rate, for sure, it depends about the size of the equipment, but in any case, we will be in a range of 80,000, 10,000 kilojoule per kilogram. So it's a really, we need a really high energetic process.
Do you offer services to develop aseptic process for particle size reduction? And the follow-up question is, what will be the minimum batch size to develop aseptic particle size reduction process?
So regarding the development of aseptic, we cannot manage this kind of development in Montage. At least I don't know regarding the development on the Quakertown site. At least I'm not able to answer to the minimum amount of material, because it's something that at least in the R&D department we cannot manage at the moment.
Okay, before we get to the question, I just remind the audience to go ahead and answer the poll question that's up on the screen and just directly answer yes or no. So on to our next question. What are the options for cryo milling? Is there anything besides liquid nitrogen?
No, at the moment we for the cryo milling we use a heat exchanger, and in particular we use the liquid nitrogen in order to cool down the process gas. Instead, in the majority of the cases, especially during development, we rely on dry ice in order to pre-cool the incoming material, so the material that has to be used for the micronization. So I can say that the standard setup is liquid nitrogen for as cooling agent for the grinding gas and the feeding gas for sure also, and the dry ice for the pre-cooling of the material.
What do you use to discharge the micronized drug substances?
So regarding the discharge, it's a different situation in function of the scale of the equipment. I can say the different options are on small scale jet mill. The standard way is to work, for example, if we work in the bottom discharge, so we discharge the product just after the passage through the jet mill, so before the product is reached the cyclone filter, we can use HDT bottle or, for example, glass bottle. Instead, if we increase the size of the equipment where we cannot rely on the bottom discharge configuration, but in the majority of the cases, it's mandatory to use the top discharge configuration, and so to collect the product under the cyclone filter, we can use a continuous liner or the single PA bag that then is put in a fiber drum or HDT drum in function of the agreement with the customer.
What's the covering capacity?
Regarding these, I can say we can, also in this case, it's difficult to answer because it's strictly related to the kind of product, but in any case, we can manage from 1 gram of product for the process development. When the customer just asks us to, which is the impact, for example, of the micronization on the API. So we need to investigate the solid state of the material before and after micronization, and we can reach several 100 kilo per hour. So it's really, we can cover a really broad range.
Well, kind of bear with me on this. How do you simulate different micronizers available either of or for or from different companies?
Yes, it is possible, considering that the energy calculation could be performed, I can say, with a different degree also of precision. It is possible to estimate the energy that was delivered, for example, on equipment that is not produced by us, just to use this data as a starting point for the process development.
What kind of particle shape can you get with a jet mill?
So regarding the particle morphology, I can say that the jet mill, at least, is not it doesn't allow a really fine control of the shape of the particle. What you will achieve at the end, in the majority of the cases, are a really sharp angle on the particle, and it is not possible, I have to say, to perform a real particle engineering at least not in a single step, in a standard micronization process or in a single step.
All right, Salvatore, we have time for one more question. We had a lot of great questions today. Unfortunately, can't get to them all, but we will be getting back to everyone who submitted personally after the webinar. So the final question is, under what circumstances is particle size reduction used for low solubility versus spray drying or HME?
So regarding these, I can say that there in some cases the different techniques can rely on similar results, but generally speaking, we can have we can use the jet mill when we need to work just on the API. So for example, in case we just need to reduce the size of the API and then use it for several additional steps in order to achieve the final formulation, the spiral jet milling is for sure the easiest way to approach the problem. In case we need to use the API for and we need to stabilize the API because, for example, we need to use it in a amorphous form, or we need to formulate it in a suspension. Some other techniques, like, for example, the spray drying could be preferable, or if we don't have any kind of issue related to the thermalability of the API, also mass extrusion. Regarding this, I don't know if Michael would like to add something more.
I guess on the bioavailability performance side, I would just add that it's often a decision about what the true rate limiting step of absorption is for an API. So particularly for size reduction, we would typically increase dissolution rate. And at some point for low solubility compounds, dissolution rate is fast enough, but solubility is limiting instead, and then we would consider formulations that can increase solubility, such as spray drying, HME, or lipid-based formulation.
All right, Michael, Salvatore, thank you. I'd also like to thank the audience for attending this Fierce Markets webinar, and Lonza for presenting today's webinar. As a reminder, the webinar has been recorded, and you will be able to access the recording within 24 hours using the same audience link that was sent to you earlier. Again, thank you for joining, and we look forward to seeing you at future events.